Okay, so yeah, I'm going to present today chapter 12, Tidy Data. Yeah, one of the main superpower of R is what I feel is Tidyverse and how it has integrated so many packages like ggplot, tibble, tidyr, readr, various and a variety of packages into a whole, into one single package called Tidyverse, and which helps you organize your data. How to make the data set tidy? So when I say tidy, I mean each variable must have its own column. Variable as in gender, name, age, and then each observation must have its own row. So in for each observation of name, gender, and age, you have particular rows with values in it. And each value must have its own cell. So example, just in the last figure, country has Afghanistan only, or cases has 745 only. How to actually materialize this concept of tidy data? One is to put each data set in a table and each variable in a column. And what is the advantage of doing this? One main advantage is the ease of management. You end up having such a clear data set. You don't have to look or select each variable and struggle with it. And another is R is very, very, R has its own superpowers of vectorization and et cetera. So it can be maximum utilization of these superpowers. Okay, what is an example of untidy data set? If you see here, we have three columns or variables, country, year, and rate, which is, and the last column is, it represents two variables, but then separated by a separator character, which is the slash. So this is an important variable. Rate is an important variable, but the representation is not quite useful. Okay, so I'm just moving to the exercises now. Using PROS, describe how the variables and observations are organized in each of the sample tables. So in Tidyverse has four sample tables, which is table one, table two, table three, table four, A and B. So table one is an example of tidy data set, which has each variable in a column, each observation in a row, and each cell slash unit has only one value. This data shows the number of cases, sorry, tuberculosis or TB cases and population in different countries by year. And table two, if you see, is an example of untidy data set. So why do I say untidy? It has each pair of rows showing similar values. So if you see country and year, Afghanistan 1999, all these are getting repeated. And for each country, the case and the population is stacked one below the other. And the third example of, table three, example of untidy data set has each row, which contains country and year. But the third column, column rate is represented as a combination of two columns, which is cases by population. Though this number is useful, but the representation is confusing. Okay, now the fourth example is actually a set of two tables where one, each row represents country and population for 2 years, either cases or either population. So this table A, 4A contains cases based on each year, and table 4B contains population based on each year. Question two. Compute the rate for table 2 and table 4 plus table 4b. You will need to perform four operations. Okay. So one is extract the number of TB cases per country per year, which is, okay. I'll just read the whole question first. Extract the matching population per country per year, divide the cases by population, and multiply by 1,000, 10,000, store back in the appropriate place. So we'll have to play around with table two, where country and year were repeated, but then cases and population were stacked one below other. So we'll have to first actually extract a type where there is cases, and then filter type population, make two different tables, and using inner join because we need to have the value of rates, which is like cases by population, and multiply it by 10,000, and then rename all of it to country, year, type, and rename rate as count again, and then add it to table two. So yeah, now with cases population, you also have the rate here. How would you do the same thing with table 4A and 4B? I actually went back to the, my old R files, and I found this method of how I used to, while not knowing R so well, I used to try to just write it this way. Call the columns using the square brackets. And yeah, this is one of the old ways. And this is so 4A and 4B show has two different tables. One shows cases and other shows population. I have just called cases 4A table 1999 and then divided it by population of 1999 and 2000 year cases divided by 2000 year population. And then hence I just make a new table and add the names like this. And then yeah, now we have a table 4C. So which of the representation was difficult? I think both of them were equally difficult. If I would have known pivoting before, I would have tried to do pivoting. But as the chapter moves on, pivoting comes later. So yeah, I try to do this with the basic R, whatever we know. Okay, so there was one plot, recreate the plot showing change in cases over time using table 2 instead of table 1. So what do you need to do first? So it's obvious, we'll have to filter type equal to cases because for table 1 it was cases, and yeah, plot it in the same way. Pivoting. Okay, most data is untidy. Most people aren't familiar with the principles of tidy data, and it's hard to derive them yourself unless you spend a lot of time working with data. And data is often organized to facilitate some use other than the analysis. For example, data is often organized to make entry as easy as possible. So yeah, I think that's one of the main way what untidy data ever I have seen is usually when people enter data set manually, and it's like there are 81 or 23,000 versions of how data can be stored. Okay, and what are the two common problems come up when we talk about pivoting? One is one variable might be spread across multiple columns. Like we saw table 4A, it had the country, then 2 years, 1999 and 2000 representing cases. Or one observation might be scattered across multiple rows. So yeah, those are the two. So we use pivot longer and pivot wider. In cases where column names are not names of variables, but values of variable, use pivot longer. So yeah, exactly the same example. You have cases here and year here. So you will try to make it longer. So this is the first table. After you use pivot longer, this is where it comes. Pivoted columns 1999 and 2000 are dropped, and their names are placed in the new year column and values in the new cases column. Similarly, pivot wider. In cases where an observation is scattered across multiple rows, use pivot wider. So the table 2, which we had, it had cases and population stacked one below other. What do? We make these two as, since they are scattered across multiple rows, we make it wider by making those two as column names and the value as their input. Observation, yeah. Okay, so usually the data is not all so pretty and simple like this, and usually the real life data what we work with is so much more complex. So yeah. Okay, questions. Why are pivot longer and pivot wider not perfectly symmetrical? carefully consider this following example. So I did not understand when I said what does it mean to be not perfectly symmetrical? So do you know what did that mean?
Oh, I'm wondering if that means that the arguments in pivot wider and pivot longer are not exactly the same.
Oh, okay.
So pivot wider, says the argument is names from. Pivot longer is names to.
Names to.
And values from and values to. So.
Oh, okay.
That's my.
To give the first argument.
Yeah, so that's the pivot wider because of the purpose, what is the purpose of pivot wider? So that's why the names are more explanatory, and so they are not the same in these two. That's my understanding, the arguments, names from and names to. And
value from and value to. Okay, that makes more sense. Yeah, I did not see the solutions. I will check that. I thought, let me try it once. But yeah, I will check what they have explained. Pivot longer has a names p-type argument. What does it do? So I tried to do that, and I found out that whenever we use pivot longer, all the column names are character by default. But names p type argument does not override this. You will have to use names transform and another argument, and then list it as numeric or as character, whatever you want to. So question two, why does this code fail? So the code is just this much: table four, pivot longer, year to, names to year, and values to cases. This is very simple. Usually you cannot represent data frames column names as just the numbers. It has either to be encoded in backticks or double inverted commas. Otherwise, it will actually take the row 1,999 and 2,000. So once we change that, we add backticks and we try to do the same thing, and we get it. So. Okay, this is an interesting question. What would happen if you widen this table? Why? How could you add a new column to uniquely identify each value? So if we widen this based on name, not names, what happens is you get multiple rows with the same IDs. So what I did here was I added a row number to uniquely identify the name and the age. So group based on name and names, that is Philip Woods and age, to identify, and then used pivot wider. So names from name and values from values. Tidy the simple data set below. Do you need to make it wider or longer? What are the variables? So the table is just this with three variables of one is pregnant, which is a character, yes or no. Another one is male and another one is female. Both of these are numeric. So I thought, why not to make it longer using male and female and change it to gender and count. So pregnant is a character or a factor, and gender again is a character, and then count is a numeric variable. So I just pivoted it to longer. Separate. Okay, so what does separate do? Separate pulls apart one column into multiple columns by splitting wherever a separator character appears. By default, it separates at non-alphanumeric character like slash, commas, dot. A specific character can also be passed in the separator argument. Or a vector of integers can also be passed to separate a column at specific position. So, and also by default, column type is preserved, but this can be controlled using convert equal to true. Okay, so this is a very important function. Though it's not as flexible as extract, is what I read also, and that's what I have experienced. unite is the reverse of separate. It binds multiple columns into a values from different columns. The default is underscore, but you can as well add, you can just say two, just count two integers and then unite them together. See whatever is there in two, just take it, yeah. Okay. Questions, what do extra and fill arguments in separate do? Experiment with the various options for the following two toy data sets. Okay, so we have this one table which has A, B, C, and D, E, F, G, and H, I, J. So if we want to separate it into three columns, one, two, three, we get an error of expected three pieces, additional pieces discarded in one rows. That is because we gave three columns, three variables, but then the third, second variable or observation had four values. So it had to discard G, but it shows a warning and doesn't stop the code. Another one is how do you separate when the values are lesser? So expected three pieces, missing pieces filled with any. With NA in one row. How to, we'll see an example of how to use extra and fill. So extra and fill arguments help in dealing with extra, more or fewer columns than expected based on the new column names. So extra has the options of warning, dropping or merging. Fill has of warning left or right. So just one example of it, if we add the argument extra and parameter merge, what happens is, and if we add fill, so instead of having, when it's two, it gets filled by left. So the first one is any, and then it starts getting filled by the next one. So yeah. Both unite and separate have a remove argument. What does it do? Why would you set it false? So what does remove do? Whenever you add remove argument and true, the older columns which were present will get removed. And false, if you keep it false, which is default, then the older columns are preserved. Columns, because that is where you were analyzing your data, and it would be just like behaving like mutate here. So yeah. The last question, compare and contrast separate and extract. Why are there three variations of separation by position, by separator and with groups, but only one unite? So the function separate splits a column into multiple columns by separator if the SEP argument is a character vector, or by character position if SEP is numeric. The function extract uses regular expression to specify groups in character vector and split that single character vector into multiple columns. And I think this book also has a chapter called strings, where we'll discuss more about extract. This is more flexible than separate because it does not require common separator or a specific column position. In other words, extract and separate, only one column can be chosen, but there are many choices on how to split that single column into different columns. But with unite, there are many choices as to which columns to include, but only one choice as to how to combine their contents into a single vector. So yeah, those are the main differences of separate, extract, and unite. Any questions? I think that's all. I will do the remaining portion. I did not think that I will finish it so fast.
Oh, that's yeah, that's okay, Aditi. I think it's also fewer people, so you know, there are fewer questions. So how much is remaining?
Yeah.
Will you do it? What else is remaining? Missing values, case study. Okay. So you will cover it.
Missing values and case study.
Okay. So do you plan to cover it next time?
Yeah, I'll finish it quickly, and I'll also request somebody else to start it because I think it's really small.
Okay.
I didn't finish it this yesterday, so I had to stop, but I can ask somebody to present relational data.
Okay. I think that was great. Thank you. I really liked how you integrated the exercises in the presentation itself. So that was really good. I was wondering, so my book actually is older. Like I have the hard copy and it has gather and spread with keys and value instead of the pivot wider. So that's just a note to self. And if anyone is referring to an older book, that it will have gather and spread. So just look online for the newer, because the pivot longer and pivot wider have different argument names.
It actually in R as well, like as soon as you start to use gather, it shows you that it's deprecated or deprecated. It's no more, nobody's working on that package. So it's eventually going to die down.
I have actually not worked with, I don't know, maybe I've worked with it during Excel times, but since I've started using R, I don't think I have worked with untidy data. So, which is, I'm very lucky. So it was useful to see the examples of untidy data in the chapter. And I wanted to know, I wanted to ask you, Aditi, what examples of untidy data have you seen and the sources, if you remember?
Okay. So I have seen the untidy data sets. Like I was saying, once I was just correcting a GPS point file, which was collected by somebody on their field when I was in Goa as well. So they had collected GPS points data in multiple different formats. So when I say multiple different formats, they would have, so lat-long comes in two different forms, right? Degree decimal minute, degree decimal, then DMS, and then, all these various types. So somebody will write 12, 47, 77, something like that. And others will write 12 point something. So both of them mean the same, but the representation is different. Mm-hmm. Or they write the name of the person. If it's Aditi, they will write, it will be the same person, Aditi, but A-D-I-T-H-I, A-D-I-T-I. So that is one of the most untidy data set I have ever seen. And it is, I don't know how to do it in R perfectly even now. I had to do some manual work there as well, like try to extract, separate all of them based on the same, separate and extract, and then see how many columns it will spread into, and then try to manually inspect which columns to multiply, which columns to add, and how to remove, using janitor of changing all of them to lower cases in names, and then trying to see if there's any familiarity in the first three names, first three letters of the name. So it has been a very untidy data set. I don't think it can be more untidy than that.
So like I have had messy data set where I have to clean a lot, but this one, this example of, several variables or several observations spread across the data set, and multiple, so that I have not had, fortunately. And I have had cases where the factor data is coded differently in different, like the same variable factors are coded differently from one year to the next to the next. And so you have to go back and recode that so that you're not changing any data by doing that.
Yeah,
as such, gather and spread I have used mostly in ggplot to group data for
ggplot. Even me, I have stopped using melt and reshape because pivot has been so helpful for everything.
Yeah, I also wanted to ask you, Aditi, have you used the separate and unite or extract?
I have used extract, separate. Sometimes when it's like cases by population kind, cases slash population, I have never used unite till now. I didn't have a problem of having to variables to combine into one. I am happy when they are separate together, separate.
Yes. I think that's it. I don't have any questions. Any more questions?
Okay. Yeah, I'll just inform in the group that if somebody can take relational data, or I can as well present it if nobody is there. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Aditi.
Yeah, bye. Thank you so much. Yeah. Bye-bye. Bye.